Okay, thank you very much. First of all, some folks asked for more elementary introduction. They are not elementary, but I will name two books. Okay, one of them is Polyakov's Gauge Fields and Strings. It is actually more than a book. You can really read a story there. It's more or less like a novel. And the other one is lectures by Witten in QFT for mathematicians. So those two are very useful. Those two are fundamental musts. Okay. So I discussed yesterday something I called deformed Young-Mills. Okay. It was a Young-Mills theory with some double trace deformation. So I took Young-Mills theory and added to it some delta S, which is a deformation. What happened is that I considered this theory on R3 times S1. Okay, this is the S1 circle. Normally, let's say this is the deformation axis, delta S, you know, providing information about delta S. Normally, this theory is a phase transition, confinement, deconfinement, which is already mentioned multiple times. But with sufficiently large deformation, we have seen that we can actually continuously connect the theory on R4 to sufficiently small circle without any phase transition according to standard gauge invariant order parameters. There are this part is conjectural, but you know, the solution here is real, okay? The solution based on monopoles I provided yesterday is perfectly fine. And this continuity, let's put a question mark here. It's only shown by numerical lattice simulations for whatever it's worth. But the big picture was, when we do this, the big picture was, on R3 times small S1, we obtain a picture of confinement very similar to what Polyakov argued in the mid-70s. Okay. We show that there are topological configurations in this theory. Their proliferation, the fact that they become finite density, is sufficient for the system to gap out, also to generate confinement. And I want to talk about some aspects of this theory, which are there in the theory on R3 cross S1, but not for the theory, for the Polyakov model. In particular, Young-Mills theory has a theta angle. So theta angle multiplies topological charge. So this is the term that is already present there. I want to briefly tell you the effect of the theta angle, how it comes about and what it does. In particular, for example, Nati yesterday mentioned an interesting mixed anomaly at theta equal pi. I want to show you how semiclassics produce that. It is quite non-trivial, actually. It's at least interesting. And I also want to tell you one more thing. I devoted quite a bit of long time and also a community of people to these studies on R3 cross S1. One part of it is really to understand a gauge theory on small circle in a regime that we can understand it. And I was always asked the question of whether we can do anything on R4, which is extremely difficult theory. And my answer was always no, okay? On more recent 4 or 5 years, I did something which looks like naively retrograde, step back. You know, I studied gauge theories on R2 times T2, and at first it looks like it is a step back because we want to go a dimension up, but we decided to go dimension down with two of the flux. But we understood something very bizarre. In particular, we were also able to solve the theory semi-classically in this construction. And both of them are semi-classically reliable. they are not any less reliable than Polyakov model, and confinement mechanism comes out to be different. Okay, and how to connect these two is still not known. Another interesting input is that, as I said, for a long time, I thought the theories in infinite spaces, R4 or R2, were maybe hopeless. But there have been many insights provided by these studies on R3 cross S1 and R2 times T2. Now I am cautiously optimistic that we can make genuine progress in field theories on infinite spaces. Okay. Now, yesterday I showed that this theory has monopoles. They proliferate in the vacuum, and they generate a potential due to monopoles. So I will not care about numerical factors in situations that I do not have to care about them, okay? But I will care about them whenever they are important. So we derive this potential exponential of S monopole, and monopole action happens to be instanton action divided by N, importantly. And I wrote this as exponential I, alpha 1 dotted with sigma dot all the way I alpha n dotted with sigma. This was the sometimes called KK monopole, doesn't matter, plus complex conjugate. This is the part coming from monopoles, and there is complex conjugate is coming from anti-monopoles. I also mentioned that we can add the theta term. You can do this in multiple different ways. You can put theta wherever you find convenient up to a field redefinition. Let us momentarily put theta here, I theta. The crucial thing is following. If you take the product of all of these operators, product of minus monopole, exponential I alpha I dotted with sigma, with the last one, I is equal 1 to n, but for alpha n dot sigma, there's also a theta, you will obtain, because some of the alpha I is equal 1 to n is 0, you will obtain some neutral object. This object is nothing but four-dimensional instanton. So, okay, this thing comes out to be exponential of minus S instanton exponential I theta. So actually, if you want, you can put theta over n everywhere. It doesn't matter. But these things are literally, in this construction, the instanton, BPSD instanton of the four-dimensional theory literally fractionates to n constituents. Okay. Now let me make a few remarks. One of them is, where do this sigma live? Sigma has the content of the gauge field. It is U1 to the n minus 1 gauge field, abelian gauge field in dualized form. Okay. Say that? No, theta. Either you can put it, theta is only here. Okay, only on the last one. But you can also put each one of them individually. It's a field redefinition. Actually, the moment now I will do a calculation, it will become clear. You can really put it anywhere up to a field redefinition, okay? But for example, let me call this thing alpha 1 dotted with sigma y1, okay? This thing here, alpha n dotted with sigma, since alpha n is equal to minus alpha I is equal to 1 to n minus 1, you can rewrite this potential as follows. I will erase this. You can rewrite this potential as something like this, as monopole exponential minus plus I y1 plus I y n minus 1 plus exponential I y. Now yn is minus y1 plus y2 plus ... yn minus 1 plus I theta. Okay, this is my potential plus complex conjugates, okay? Now, I just called some, you know, alpha I dotted with sigma y, okay? Now, if you look to critical points of this potential, this is this part is some combination, that part is complex conjugate, you can actually show that. So let us look at it. Del V over del Y I is I times exponential I Y I minus I times exponential minus I Y1 plus Y n minus 1 plus I theta. Okay. Now, this is equal to plus complex conjugate, but we do not have to worry about it. The extremum is still the same. You see that we are now setting, trying to find the saddle point dominating the path integral. You see that this thing, for this equation to be satisfied, must be equal to the right-hand side. The equation, this implies this is equal to zero. It means that this object here is independent of I. Let me call this object x. X is equal to, on the right-hand side, I have x to the minus n minus 1 exponential I theta. So it tells you that x to the n is exponential I theta, and x is exponential I theta over n plus I 2 pi k divided by n. This is some now n plausible vacua of this theory on R3 times S1. There is a common lore about Young-Mills theory. It is believed that as a function of theta, it is the observables in this theory are multi-branch functions where each branch is 2 pi n periodic as a function of theta, but the combination of them is 2 pi periodic. Now, indeed, if you look at this, and if you go ahead and calculate theta dependence of the vacuum, so there are multiple plausible vacua, and E sub k of theta happens to be minus exponential S monopole and cosine theta plus 2 pi k divided by n. This is the kth branch. But if you are looking to vacuum branch, what you have to do is vacuum E0 of theta is min over k of minus exponential S monopole cosine theta plus 2 pi k divided by n. Okay, so there are multiple functions there. Okay, and let me plot this for, let's take n equal 4. I can, let's plot these vacuum energy densities for different branches. So n equal 4, one of the branches like that. The other branch is like this. This is 8 pi. Another branch is like this. And another branch looks like this. And this point here is actually 2 pi. This one is k equal 0 branch. In my convention there, this one is k equal minus 1 branch. And this one is k equal minus 2 branch. And this one is k equal minus 3 branch. Okay, you see that the vacuum here between theta equal, between pi and minus pi, the vacuum is in this k equal zero branch, but something interesting happens at theta equal pi. Okay, here these two branches, k equal zero branch and k equal minus one branch, they are degenerate. Okay. Now this is interesting. This is actually this is both manifestation of anomaly as well as Nati mentioned in his lecture at theta equal pi. In his quantum mechanical example, simple quantum mechanical example, as well as in pure Yang-Mills theory, you have in the pure Yang-Mills theory, you have a CP symmetry. And that CP symmetry do get spontaneously broken. And there are indeed two vacua here. So the order parameter for this is trace F, which F 1 over 8 pi square, this thing, topological charge density. That's a very good question. The answer is generically no. They actually, some of them, he's asking, are they really always metastable local minima? And the answer to that depends on the theory, depends on the details of the theory. For example, in this theory, the answer is no. I am pretty sure of that. In super Yang-Mills, softly broken with a mass term, the answer is yes. Okay. Now, this is interesting because you obtain this multi-branch structure, and multi-branch structure is an indicative of non-perturbative physics. It tells you that you are doing something right, okay? And if you look to this order parameter, okay, I will also spend 30 seconds on that because actually this picture of having monopole around, and you know, I made this picture, you know, if you really think three-dimensional Euclidean space, take a snapshot of it in the Euclidean context. In the Euclidean context, there are really these physical objects, you know, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, so on and so forth. And you are essentially calculating the expectation value of this, and you can actually easily show that, let me not do the details, this is non-zero. Actually, is a function of theta. This is some sawtooth function. This is theta equal pi. Okay, so you see that it has two possible values at theta equal pi. This is the order parameter, topological charge density. There is one more thing I want to tell you, and after that I will move on to QCD adjoint. The one more thing is following. Let us take SU2 gauge theory, okay? If you look at the SU2 gauge theory, okay, SU2 is broken down to U1, you only have two types of monopole operators. M1 is exponential minus S monopole, exponential I sigma plus I theta over 2, let's write around mean field, m2 equal to S monopole exponential minus I sigma plus I theta over 2. If you sit down, there is m1 bar, there is m2 bar. If you sit down and add them up, something very interesting happens. Actually, already here, there is something already interesting. Now, you were to interpret this thing as the density of the topological configurations, but now it is combined. This is a field, whatever it is, but this is also a parameter, theta. This is combined with this parameter. In some sense, the density became complex. It's a complex fugacity. It is not only special to this system, it also appears in two-dimensional Heisenberg N-type ferromagnets. But I want to point you to the following. If you write the potential here, minus S monopole, and after just some brief algebra, cosine theta over 2, cosine sigma. You immediately see that this looks nice in certain sense. This part by dimensional transmutation will give a mass to the sigma field, which is related to the strong scale. Very nice, we are happy with that. But if you take theta equal pi, something very interesting happens. The term proportional to monopoles becomes zero. Okay, theta equal pi, this thing is at this order, becomes zero, okay? Interesting. But the monopoles are there. They have finite density, they are still omnipresent, they didn't disappear, but their effect disappeared. This is some form of destructive interference in a Euclidean sense, however, between these monopoles. And if you go ahead and try to calculate second order terms, okay, there is an event which is, there is a second order in the, either you can call it fugacity expansion or cluster expansion. You see that symmetries allow you to write a term like this, exponential some coefficient cosine 2 sigma. Okay, it's second order, and you can actually look at this object, M1, M2 bar, and I will give the justification of this in a moment, but if you look to M1, M2 bar, it doesn't have a topological charge, but it does in the, you know, usual topological charge, but it does have a magnetic charge. Magnetic charge is plus 2. So this object is proportional to minus 2s monopole 2i sigma, and it tells you that in the vacuum, we also have to consider these objects. You know, this picture that I have drawn here, okay? You also have to put there these little pictures, plus, plus, M1, M2 bar. If you ever worked in statistical mechanics, cluster expansion, all of these terms arises iteratively in the cluster expansion, okay? So, this is interesting actually, because the fundamental domain of sigma is 0 to 2 pi. And this is what I promised to you. I told you that based on concentration on R4, we know that CP is broken. But if you look to this potential now, minus cosine 2 sigma, it has two minima. One of them is at sigma equals 0, the other is sigma equals pi. And this is related to the spontaneous breaking of CP symmetry. So this story in this sense as well seems to be adiabatically connected to the theory in large volume. Okay. No, both of them, it's minus cosine two sigma. Yeah, both of them are genuine minima. Any questions? Now, next part, I will take it more slowly, next part. Okay. Now, this is more or less all I want to say about this Deformier-Mills theory on R3 cross S1. Now, I will move to this very interesting theory, QCD with adjoint fermions. NF adjoint fermions, these are NF of them, lambda sub I index goes from 1 to NF. For asymptotic freedom, NF needs to be less than 5.5, okay, for whatever it is worth. This is an interesting theory. It only has adjoint matter. It has Lagrangian. Let me not bother to write, but I will consider this theory again on R3 cross S1, okay? And this is my Polyakov loop going around the circle, but I will consider this theory not with the usual partition function, But instead with this graded partition function, exponential minus LH minus 1 to the power F, let me call it Z tilde L. This theory is very interesting. Why is it interesting? Let me give you a very basic intuition. If you are in QCD in which NF is even, okay, number of flavors is even, if you were to consider this quantity here, because it will be equal to, these are equal for QCD with fundamental fermions, because if you look to the spectrum, even baryons are bosons, right? For NC even or NF even? And well, yeah, okay. And yeah, okay. But this object here, okay, let me stick with the QCD adjoint. It is not just sum of the states in the Hilbert space, but it is sum over bosonic states. There is no baryon, yeah. I just got, okay, you sum over bosons, okay, but it tells you there is a minus sign, and there is E sub n sum over fermions, okay? This minus sign is crucial, because here is a remark. If you take NF equal one theory, this is a theory that many people likes a lot. It is supersymmetric, minimally supersymmetric Young-Mills theory. This theory, in a technical sense, the only QCD-like theory, vector-like theory, among supersymmetric theories, you know, in the technical definition of the vector, like there is no scalar fields, but in all other theories, you will end up having scalar fields. So, and this quantity there is nothing but the Witten index. So, and I mentioned that this quantity is a constant. Now, I will do something interesting. This thing amounts to the following. If you are considering PET integral formulation for this operator, this thing will correspond. The unusual thing is that this thing will correspond to not anti-periodic, but periodic boundary condition for fermions. So, as I said, if you want to do thermal physics, you have to put anti-periodic boundary condition. But if you want to consider this theory on, for example, R2,1 times S1, genuine Minkowski space, but you compactified one of the space directions, okay? If you want to consider there, this is what you have to do. Then there is a PET integral over this, okay? This makes some things very interesting. First of all, from supersymmetric theory, if you consider this holomorphic potentials, this consider this potential for the gauge holonomy. I told you yesterday, this was something, some factors here, 1/L^4, some things that I am ignoring, trace omega n, square divided by n to the 4. This was in pure Young-Mills, okay? But you know that the result is must be zero in supersymmetric theory. So whatever you do here, in supersymmetric theory, bosonic potential will still be there. There will also be contribution from fermion. The fermion contribution is actually opposite of the boson contribution. Since we are imposing the same boundary condition for bosons as well as fermions, there is no, this is quite natural that this thing vanishes. And also the crucial thing is that the representation of fermion is same as, is adjoint, same as the gauge bosons. If you put NF fermions, you do get something super interesting. You do get this coefficient to be positive. And it may not mean much to the most of the audience, maybe, but this actually, this positive sign is very crucial. You know, it is the first time that this kind of potential calculation for gauge holonomies produce a positive coefficient there, which tells you that Polyakov loops must be non-tachyonic. Okay, so then the condition, then the thing, the minimum of this is that trace omega, as I discussed yesterday, omega to the k is equal to zero for all k not equal zero mod n. Okay, so this is something fascinating because it tells you that this theory abelianizes on R3 cross S1. And if you look to the eigenvalues, let me again put for SU4, eigenvalues go like that, which is very nice. These are omega exponential IV1, exponential IV4, and these are the eigenvalues, V1, V2, V3, V4. Well, is that clear? Okay. Now, as a result, if you go to long distance physics, first of all, there is again the same situation I told you yesterday. There is running coupling, right? Running starts to run, but you know, go up. But in this theory, at scale 1/L here, okay, the running coupling stops to run. It goes, it plateaus, it becomes a constant. This is the scale roughly 1/L. What happens next? If you are starting with some SUN gauge theory, as a result of this, the theory abelianizes and reduces to U1 to N-1. And as I discussed yesterday, there are again monopole events, monopole instantons. These are not particles in Minkowski spacetime. You know, these are spacetime events, points in the Euclidean spacetime. Okay, so there are these configurations, topological configurations, and you can ask, what do they do? Do they generate confinements? This is actually interesting question in the following sense. If I were to consider something, actually, some people in the past, 1982, there is a beautiful paper by Affleck, Carvey, and Witten. Affleck, Carvey, and Witten in the early 80s. They consider a theory very similar to this. For example, you can consider dimensional reduction of n equal 1 super Young Mills on R4 down to R3. Okay, and on R3 it becomes n equal 2 super Young Mills. This paper was mentally very influential on me. I learned many things from there. If you look to the counterpart of this theory on R3, it actually does not confine. It doesn't even have it has something special to supersymmetric. It has a runaway vacuum. Vacuum is at infinity in the field space, and I will show you why. Okay, but the theory I describe you on R3 cross S1 confines, and they look like almost same theories. And many people, actually, from Polyakov to this beautiful paper, thought that, you know, when you have Polyakov model with some sort of fermions very likely it will not confine. So what do we need to know to understand this theory? We know there are monopoles. We can write monopole operators. But, well, whenever we have topological objects, right, there are, in this case, there will be topological objects with topological charge 1 over n. And there is also topological charge 1 instanton. Now, let me move back here. I did not tell you some things about symmetries because, you know, I always make an emphasis on dynamics, but you cannot be negligent of symmetries. They are very important. Let me tell you what are the symmetries here. There are NF fermions. So you have SU NF symmetry. There is a U1 axial, but it is anomalous. Because of the instanton, it is reduced to Z2N NF. And because it is adjoint matter, there is also Zn one-form symmetry. Okay, you know, up to a double counting, a possible double counting there, this is the symmetry that you have. In particular, there is this axial symmetry. Okay, this now let me take for simplicity NF equal one. Okay. First of all, I can tell you the reason why I can get rid of this. So if you look to the instanton amplitude, it is trace lambda I, lambda j, and the power, okay, for one flavor, okay, the instanton for trace lambda lambda to the power n exponential s instanton. If you look to axial charge violation, delta q5, this is equal to 2n, okay? So this tells you that u1 axial is reduced down to Z2n. And for multi-flavor, you can put multiple copies of these fermions and it's reduced to Z2n NF. Now, however, if you have a topological charge plus minus one over n configuration, then on that topological configuration, it looks like you have you can write an index. You have these monopoles must have some fermionic zero modes. This is some version of Atiyah-Padot-Isinger index theorem. More precisely, on R3 times S1 for Dirac operator on R3 cross S1, you have to provide the data on the holonomy at infinity, as well as the gauge field. There is an index theorem. It is called Nye-Singer. And it tells you that these objects, this Singer is not the Singer in the Atiyah-Padot-Isinger. This is student of Roger Penrose, mathematician. Okay. And it tells you that these objects will have two NF fermionic zero modes, each one of them. This is interesting. So you have to attach, and let me stick again NF equal one for simplicity. It tells you that there is some number of lambda, lambda, two zero modes here, two zero modes there. There will be some zero modes attached to these monopoles. Okay. This is interesting because this prevents monopoles from generating confinement or mass gap. If you have, for example, two species of fermions, for example, if NF were two, this generates a quartic, you know, lambda one, lambda one, lambda two, lambda two. It generates a quartic, which is even worse, it looks like. Okay, it really gives an interaction between sigma and these fields, but it doesn't give a mass term. It doesn't generate a purely bosonic potential, cosine sigma. Now, let me tell you something very interesting. So let us again stick with go back to NF equal one, roughly speaking. Okay, NF equal one. This is lambda lambda M1 bar exponential minus I sigma lambda bar lambda bar. Let me stay with SU2 gauge theory broken down to U1. Okay. And M2 bar is exponential plus I sigma lambda bar lambda bar. Okay, this kind of structure here. So at the level of monopoles, you will not see generation of mass gap or confinement for the gauge fluctuations. Okay, but now I told you for NF equal one, the axial symmetry of this theory, honest axial symmetry of this theory was Z2 NF and C4. Okay, but if you look, there is something weird about that monopole operator. If you look to fermion bilinear, and the action of this thing is lambda goes to exponential 2 pi I divided by 4 times lambda, it tells you that lambda lambda goes to exponential 2 pi 4 pi I times lambda lambda. Interesting, lambda lambda is not invariant, but this thing is an honest symmetry of the theory. It is not anomalous. It is the anomaly free part of the theory, okay? So it must be a theory of the effective field theory as well, okay? So what's happening? The answer is following, exponential I sigma lambda lambda. In order for this monopole operator to be invariant under this symmetry, you must have exponential I sigma goes to exponential I sigma plus I pi. Okay. Where does this come from? Why did this happen? There is actually very simple, beautiful explanation for this. And it's following. I will come back to this. Okay. Okay. So when you consider dual theory, okay, so if you ignore the monopoles, if you ignore the monopoles altogether, the dual theory was del sigma square, the Lagrangian, which was G square times del sigma square, if you ignore the monopoles. Ignoring monopoles, the shift symmetry, this has a shift symmetry which protects its masslessness. Let me call this U1J. It's a shift symmetry. And you can ask, what is its current? Okay. Well, its current is E sigma. If you look to current conservation, okay, but maybe star D sigma. D sigma is fine. If you look to current conservation, but this thing is related to the magnetic field. The punchline is following. The current is actually essentially magnetic field. And the current conservation is del dot B is equal to zero. As long as there are no monopoles, you know, this tells you, as long as there are no monopoles, there is this U1 shift symmetry for which the current is the magnetic field, okay? But when there are monopoles, of course, the right-hand side is not zero. But then this U1J, which used to be a shift symmetry, this one makes a marriage proposal to this axial symmetry, and the two combines, and the symmetry that is in the infrared is actually in the diagonal of these two. Okay, so this thing is actually a manifestation of this axial symmetry with the shift symmetry. Now, this is interesting. This thing, this symmetry, certainly tells you something. It tells you what? It tells you that if you want to write down cosine sigma, this is forbidden. If you want to write down cosine 3 sigma, this is forbidden as well. Okay, actually any cosine odd number times sigma is forbidden by a shift symmetry. But how about cosine 2 sigma? Certainly this thing is not forbidden by this symmetry. Okay. Question is following. What is this object? Okay, it is allowed by symmetries, and what is this? So let's do that. If you look up there, you see there is an M1, M2, M1 bar, M2 bar. This object would be sourced by something It's by something which has magnetic charge Q. If you look up there, if you look to M1 and M2 bar, this one is exponential I sigma lambda lambda, and this one is also exponential I sigma lambda bar lambda bar. We can actually look to the interaction between these two, okay? So there are two things. Naively, these two things are repulsive, okay? So the interaction between V interaction between M1 and this one and two bar, there is a repulsive part, which is one over G square, one over four pi R, which is coming from the magnetic charges of these objects. But these things can do something interesting. If I draw a picture, this is plus, it has fermion zero modes. This is plus, it also has fermion zero modes, but these are of opposite chirality. You can actually soak up the fermion zero mode of this one with that one. If you construct correlator of this thing, right, it will give you fermion propagator square. Okay. If you look at this thing, this is at X, this is at Y. If you look to this correlator in the free theory, this will give you exponential minus V int, okay? I already discussed yesterday, this part gave this interaction. Let us look at this part. In the previous lecture, you have seen propagator for fermions. It is one over P slash, right? Everybody knows. So as propagator for fermion in momentum space is one over P slash. You can do Fourier transform of this to real space. And it is gamma mu X minus Y mu X minus Y cube. Morally speaking, it goes like one over X square, X minus Y square, okay? So this object here, there is a fermion propagator square, SF square. It behaves like one over X minus Y to the power four. Now you can take this put it into the exponents, you will see something strange. Here you will get 4 times logarithm of r. R is x minus y. What happens? So there was this object plus, it had some number of zero modes. There was this object plus, it also had some number of zero modes. These things are exchanged, okay? And there is an interaction between them. Then the interaction, let me rewrite this. Roughly speaking, 1 over g square 4 pi 1 over r plus 4 log r. Interesting. So fermions generated an attractive interaction. This is something also well known from the old QCD literature by various people. If you plot this potential, this part is like Coulomb repulsion. And there is also log r, which is an log r is much slower. It is a log attraction. And if you look to this potential, you know, combination of these two, it has a structure like that. It is a nice minimum here, okay? In calculating this kind of, now, the idea here is very similar. The idea in the cluster expansion in general is very similar to renormalization group. You are integrating over length scales. If we integrate over length scales at which at distances, let me call this R star, at distances larger than R star, okay? These objects here will look like, you know, they are like molecules sitting there. They will look like point charges from sufficiently large distances with point charge plus Q. So they will generate these potentials. Apart from M1, M2, you will also generate this M1, M2 bar, which I also wrote down in the Puri-Yang-Mills theory. They will generate this operator, 2i sigma. So this object has a magnetic charge plus Q and topological charge zero. So it is really, in some sense, the composite of this thing. The vacuum, apart from these monopoles, anti-monopoles, and plenty of them, n types of them, it also has this kind of correlated events, M1, M2 bar, or M2, M1 bar. And what do they do? First of all, an operator like minus cosine 2 sigma. Well, certainly it will generate mass gap for gauge fluctuations, no doubt. It will also generate electric confinements, very similar to the Polyakov model. Any questions so far? Okay. Now, let me be a little bit more honest, okay? The more detailed and more precise things, okay? I actually cheated a little bit, okay? Let me tell you where I cheated exactly, okay? It doesn't change any of the conclusions I made, but it is important, okay? First of all, we started with a gauge theory, right? Which was F mu nu square, and from here, I had an A4 gauge field and AI gauge fields that I had, you know, I had dualized into sigma. A4 behaved as some sort of adjoint Higgs field, okay? And Good. Here is one place I partially deceived you. Actually, this A4 is a scalar. If you are in the supersymmetric theory, step back. If you go back to our holonomy potential, it was okay. Okay, we have to do this, unfortunately. It wasn't so hard after all. Okay. I wrote this holonomy potential, and it was like this: Nf minus one times trace omega n square divided by n to four. First of all, this thing is proportional to the mass square of A4. A4 is classically massless in the Nf equal one case, supersymmetric case. I actually lied to you quite a bit there in the supersymmetric case, but not in the non-supersymmetric cases. If Nf greater than one, okay, then A4 is massive, and A4 exchange between monopole, it's not a big deal, okay? It is short range. But if I want to correct myself, and let me give a different name to A4, you know, which will look more harmonious with sigma, let me call this phi, okay? So actually, if I were more honest with you, for the monopole operator, I would write phi plus I sigma, okay? For the M2, I would write exponential minus phi minus I sigma. And here, phi minus I sigma. And here, I would write exponential minus phi plus I sigma. Okay? This phi is the holonomy field. So for the M1, M2 bar, I told you, I didn't lie to you completely. Phi is canceled and sigma is combined, and it gave you cosine 2 sigma. It generated a mass gap. Okay. For other things, there is a much deeper story that I can tell here. So if you look something like, for example, again, proceeding in this cluster expansion, if you look to this M1, M1 bar, this looks very troublesome. You know, both scalar interactions as well as Fermi zero mode attractions, both of them looks attractive. And I will not do justice to this one here, but there is a way to go around these obstacles. But if you look at it naively, it looks like M1, M1 bar looks like exponential minus 2 s monopole plus 2 phi. And M2 bar looks like exponential minus 2 sm exponential minus 2 phi. So if you combine them, they will give you something which looks like cosine hyperbolic 2 phi. Combine them, it will give cosine hyperbolic 2 phi. So it is as if they want to keep center symmetry stable. But I must admit, it is not easy to understand these configurations, because at least in the old QCD literature, people were thinking that if you bring an instanton and anti-instanton together, you know, they must annihilate. It is true that, you know, the topological charge zero, but they cannot annihilate. These are not, you know, as a configuration, it can be smoothly connected to vacuum by deformation, but it is a tunneling happens followed by tunneling other way, okay? So you see that these are not trivial operators. M1, M1 bar is not identity, and it generates some non-trivial effect. And the part of the story I am not telling you, I just want to mention in few words. These things are here, but there was this sketch I made. This sketch I made. If I try to make the same sketch for, first of all, for this M1, M1 bar, M1, M1 bar attracts, in the bosonic sense, attract each other. This sign was plus for the M1, M2 bar, but it is minus for M1, M1 bar. So there are, actually, this is attractive, and this one is also attractive. So, you know, the combination looks like that, not good. Okay, it looks sort of troublesome. But I am glossing over bigger story here. There is a bigger story, and I will just give few words about it, then say few words about it, then move on. Okay. Probably every one of you heard something called steepest descent approximation. Or steepest descent or stationary phase approximation. How many people heard something about steepest descent approximation or studied it? Thank you very much. I really appreciate. Okay, very good. Actually, in the steepest descent approximation, let you first determine your saddle point. And then attached to each saddle, even if you are doing, if you want to do integral on the real line, okay, attached to each saddle, you find the steepest descent path. Even your original is integral, is over reals, steepest descent paths go to the complex domain. They are still lines, they are still one-dimensional. You can define integrals on the steepest descent paths, and the virtue of it, the integral is bound to be convergent, okay? So, good. The reason I told you this, steepest descent method or saddle point method is the most basic of the semi-classical methods. It is actually also probably the most fundamental. But step zero of this procedure tells you the following. The steepest descent line, even if your variable lives in the real domain, steepest descent line goes to the complex domain. Interesting, right? These things, actually, these objects, M1, M2 bar, as well as M1, M1 bar, these objects, they are actually, in a precise sense, something called critical points at infinity. The classical part of the interaction is really just 1 over r. Del v over del r vanishes only at r equal infinity. These are critical points at infinity. You can regularize this system. Then you can go ahead and do an integral over this separation, what you thought to be the separation between them, over the steepest descent cycle. If it is plus, steepest descent cycle is something that you would associate very naturally. You know, it looks something on the real line, you are happy with it. But if it is minus, steepest descent contour is actually quite different from the steepest descent contour of the other case. It is actually steepest ascent contour of the other case. Okay, so when you do these things properly by using semi-classics properly, this object yet that you define here, M1, M1 bar or M2, M2 bar, they are actually meaningful things as long as you do your integration over the separation on the steepest descent cycle. Probably one of the most important things about semi-classics is that, you know, despite the fact that you may do a path integral over fields, over real fields, and you know, something which looks very reasonable. Whenever you say the word semi, without reaching to classics part, okay, semi-classics, you have to complexify your space, okay? This is step zero. You have to think more broadly. And if you think of these objects, then there is a proper way to define this, and it gives you that. There is... Probably one more, there is even more interesting story in the game. If you actually do this, but I shouldn't say anything about it. So I was going to say something, but let me hold myself. But it is something related to something called resurgence. That's all. Any questions on this? Now, what is the vacuum of QCD adjoint? So the vacuum is composed of, let me make a picture for you. It is a statistical field theory, okay? It has plus charges, minus charges, doesn't matter. Both orientations are possible. It also has these objects, plus, plus, minus, minus. So it is full of them. If you write down, some statistical field theory corresponding to proliferation of these events, this gives you the long distance theory of the QCD adjoint, okay? And this theory, as I said, it is confining. And let me say a few things how the confinement arises. I can describe it either in a real space sense or in the Euclidean space. It doesn't really matter. Okay. But let me say a few things on that. Okay. Any questions? Okay. 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 Now you have generated this potential. Okay. So, and if you are, of course, considering more general SUN, okay, SUN broken down to you want the n minus one, then these monopole operators are alpha I, phi plus I, alpha I dotted with sigma, alpha I lambda, phi lambda with appropriate things. And there is a minus exponentialist monopole. There is a summation over them. And there are also these things, cosine alpha I minus alpha I plus one dotted with sigma, and this kind of things at 2S monopole order. So you obtain a theory like this. And if you find the minimum, it tells you that discrete chiral symmetry is broken. You can do that. But now let me say something on confinement. Maybe in the simplest case, let me say something about confinement. So electric charge, as I briefly mentioned in the previous class, in this dual formulation, is the vortex of the sigma field, okay? So you can write del dot E, because of the duality relation, very good. I think if you look to that duality relation, I wrote EX is del Y sigma and EY is minus del X sigma. And del dot E integrals, this is charge, right? Q, some Q electric. you can actually map it to circulation of the sigma field. This is equal to the circulation of the sigma field. If you have a sigma, if you have a vortex of sigma, this is your electric charge. Let's take an again electric charge here with charge Q and minus Q. Okay. This part is a little bit repetition of the last class, but maybe I can say it in two different ways. One of them is, of course, if electric field spreads uniformly in an empty space, it causes a potential which is log R. You can check this. You can check the energy of a point electric. You can write a vortex, naive vortex. But if you okay, let me keep this. However, if you have a medium which is magnetically charged, the uniformly spreading electric field causes an energy which is proportional to the whole volume of the space. In this case, it's a two-dimensional system, it's the area. It is actually, the thing I am telling you is the dual of the Meissner effect. If you have a superconductor and apply it some magnetic field is expelled. It cannot enter, right? But if you crank up magnetic fields, it can leak in, but it can leak in some tubes, tiny tubes. And these tubes form something called Abrikosov vortex. So the superconductor gives up a little bit, but it doesn't allow the magnetic field to go everywhere because it's energetically quite unfavorable. It will cause the change of the free energy, which is proportional to the whole volume. And the thing I am telling you is the analog of that. If I consider an electric field spreading in all the directions, this will cause an energy cost will be proportional to R square, where R is the system size. But the field does something interesting. So you can make sigma zero everywhere, but you can make here delta sigma something like, you can make delta sigma non-zero here, maybe 2 pi or something like that, okay? Which corresponds to, then maybe another way to say this is following. So then this configuration in which sigma jumps in this manner, okay? If you think this direction, you know, sigma field comes like that and it makes a discontinuous jump here, okay, by 2 pi. You can show that this leads to linear confinement. You can show this explicitly. If you want a simpler argument, think of the just now completely Euclidean context, okay? So think again of the Wilson loop. It has some area A. It has some electric current on it, and it generates a magnetic field in this direction into the magnetic conductor. But just like electric field cannot penetrate much to an electric conductor, magnetic field cannot penetrate much to the magnetic conductor either. So the magnetic, magnetically charged particles will come in here and prevent this magnetic field from penetrating to magnetic conductor. And there is a characteristic thickness here. And this characteristic thickness is the Debye length, M Debye, it's the Debye length. And this thing is also, if I erase this, in some sense, the thickness of this flux tube in the space picture. This is also m d by inverse. So the electric field can penetrate, can go through the medium, but it does something quite clever. You know, it forms this one-dimensional tube, then this leads to linear confinement between charge and negative charge, okay? And at least in this theory, on the R3 cross S1 context, this is how confinement is generated, okay? I think this is more or less all I want to say on that, yeah. Thank you.
Great questions.
It's an over the head, sorry.
Yeah, I can ask one. How do we know that we have this flux?
It's a solution of the equation of motion. If you insert the Wilson loop into the PET integral, and if you work out the details of the equation, just you can get the same picture both from the Euclidean side as well as, you know, Minkowski side. In both cases, you form a tube which has some characteristic thickness, which is more or less the Debye length.
So it's a solution of classical.
Solution of the, yeah. Solution of the, this thing that delta sigma makes a jump. Now, the point is following. You are putting a Wilson loop there, and across that Wilson loop, sigma makes a jump by 2 pi, okay? And so I wrote this effective theory, okay? So you put something here in the XY plane and sigma comes here and like that, and it makes a jump like that, okay? And here the crucial point here is that I wrote the theory based on monopoles, but it is with the insertion of this Wilson loop, with arbitrarily large, it has translational invariance in the XY. Everything depends on Z. And if you calculate action of this configuration compared to non-perturbative vacuum, action of the configuration in the presence of this Wilson loop, it will cost something proportional to area. And you also have to do a functional integral, del sigma minus cosine 2 sigma kind of thing. You have to find, you have to take this thing as a one-dimensional quantum mechanical theory. And the important point here is that the derivative here is same as derivative there. This configuration here is actually nothing but the instanton in this model. The action of this instanton gives you the coefficient of the area law. So you reduce the problem to a quantum mechanics, and this thing, this thing, delta sigma throughout this process, if you take some charge, for example, 2 pi mu k, which is in 2 pi times weight lattice, take any charge in the weight lattice, you have to consider, I wrote this for the general case, not this case. Alpha I minus alpha I plus one dotted with sigma cosine with sum over I. I wrote this general quantum mechanics, and this is an instanton in that quantum mechanics with this profile. The action of this instanton in this quantum mechanical system is the coefficient of the area law for the calculation of this Wilson loop. It's a precise calculation. In the context of Polyakov model, it's due to Polyakov in the SU2 case.